Hard Rockology Show. This is Matt filling in for Chris, who's currently on holiday. But, you know, everything has to go on here on a Hard Rockology Show. That being said, Chris ain't here. And you know what? I just had to get somebody that I think is one of the better singers and actually one of the better bands that came out of the 80s, Kingdom Come. And on the phone right now, I have Lenny Wolf, lead singer, guitarist, bass player. He basically does it all for Kingdom Come. Lenny Wolf is joining us here on a Hard Rockology Show. Lenny, welcome.
Yes, hi, boys and girls. It's Lenny. Glad to be on the show. Hallelujah. Okay, I'm trying to sound smart now. I haven't been talking in English for a while, so please pardon my accent, but I'm trying.
All right, Lenny, I do have a question I have to ask you because it's been bothering me since about 2009.
Okay, I don't want that to happen, so please ask me.
Okay,
I don't want you to bother.
I'll ask you. Basically, on the Magnify album, okay, when you open up the CD, the sleeve, you're sitting there on a tractor with a beautiful woman. I got to ask you, what's up with that tractor?
That tractor, I like that. Very, very funky. Honestly, I'm a bit thrown off now. Are you seriously asking me about the tractor or the woman sitting on it?
Well, a little bit of both. I mean, it's like one of those things. You just open up the album sleeve, you're figuring you're going to get a great picture of Lenny, maybe the guys in the band, maybe with the woman, and you're on a tractor with a hot woman.
You know, I mean, that was one of those phases in my life. Honestly, I'm so fed up with all this cliche crap, blah, please, sitting on a fucking Harley, or like looking mean or heavy, or sitting on a fucking like 14 cylinder Mustang or whatever. I mean, excuse me, I do own a Harley and I love Mustangs, but it's just those images, like working with those images kind of like became so boring. And when back then I was managed by a very good friend of mine. Her name was Martina. She's an Austrian girl, a lady from Austria. And she knew that, one of her best friends is the father of that young girl who ended up in our video. And she was so sweet, besides she's looking stunning, but she was also very smart and sweet and blah, blah, blah. So she just liked the concept of joining us. Being part of the video. So we were happy she did it. And of course, the whole band fell in love for 15 minutes, but we kind of recovered quickly. And the tractor is just something I felt like doing without any deep message or concept here, just like doing a bit more the unexpected, not sitting on a mountain trying to figure out the sense of life somewhere in Arizona during a sunset or riding the Harley, you know, all stuff I really do like, but I'm just so, I think those images are so worn out. So that's why I figured, okay, so what can I do? And we were like hanging out at a friend's place who was running a farm in Austria. And there I saw this beautiful green tractor. So I asked that guy, the big chief, can I sit on a thing? He said, sure. Is it still running? Oh, yeah, it is. Oh, please show me how. So 15 minutes later, let's start the camera. That's basically how it ended up.
All right. So let's go back a little bit, Lenny. Let's basically do a little bit of a history here of Lenny Wolf. And back in, 1983, you came here to the States and you basically formed your first band, Stone Fury, with Bruce Gowdy. So why don't you talk a little bit about that? Because listening back to that, I mean, you could definitely hear the makings of what Kingdom Come was to come. So how did that all come together?
Back in the days, I mean, let me put it this way. The last band I played with when I was still living in Germany was called Funhouse. Kind of like a Rolling Stones meets the Krauts, basically, I guess. I was singing English, not really knowing what the hell I was singing about. Just like I was loving the Beatles from day one, but never knew what they were saying. She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's funny, I never knew what it meant. It sounds really funky, but it was true. And the guitar player, Norbert, that was his name, his business partner was an American guy selling old Neve mixing consoles, which were still found in Germany, and brought them over, exported them to the States, and his partner sold them in the States to studios and blah, blah, blah. So Norbert kind of had a connection to a few people back in the States. And we just did a very simple video, you know, playing on the roof of some industrial building, you know, doing the usual, you know, spread legs and rock and roll. And how old was I? I don't know. I think I was 22 or something, or 23. And his partner back in LA got a got his hands on that video clip, and he gave it, I believe, to Marty Wolff, who ended up being Kingdom Come and also Stone Fury's manager, to say that. And back then, he was the lighting guy from the Doobie Brothers. So, I mean, what this, just thinking about it, it's very cosmic. So, and he liked the video, and he then took the video to Roy Thomas Baker, who back then was the head of A&R department for Electric Records. I guess that's what they were called back then, right? So Roy Thomas Baker and Marty Wolff got on a plane and flew to Hamburg, Germany. And they were checking us out, and we were playing, and we were all very excited. Hallelujah, great, you know, the big guys coming out here to check us out. So, you know, we were rocking out. And then a few weeks passed by, and it didn't end up to for the band to get signed. Up until today, I haven't really figured out why, but for some reason, I don't know if it got too expensive, or maybe the main dude from Electric Records didn't believe in it, or maybe he didn't like crowds. So I have no fucking idea. But but you never know the real reasons. But Marty Wolff, he called me a few days later saying, Lenny, would you like to come to LA? Man, I mean, we're talking, I was like 22 or 23. I was never like, I flew once to England before, but that was basically it. I mean, I've never sat on a plane before, so I was like static. I was very excited. Hallelujah. I've been watching American movies all day long. I figured, oh yeah, great. I'm going to meet Clint Eastwood. I can't wait. So I was very excited and said, sure, Marty, I want to come. My English back then, still terrible. I basically knew, like, I'm hungry, fuck you, and she loves you, yeah. That's all I knew.
I guess you could say it was kind of had like the Klaus Mein type of English vocabulary, I guess you could say.
Oh, yeah, probably worse, right? Exactly, yeah. So I was very excited, and I mean, so Marty invited me, and he paid for the ticket. And there I was, like, dressed in leather, all ready to rock, and then, like, arriving in LA at, like, 100 degrees, so hallelujah. I was certainly dressed wrong, but it was great. I mean, we're talking sitting on airplanes before the fucking, you know, 9/11 happened. You were still able to talk to pilots. I mean, it was just great. It was a great time. So there I was in LA. He invited me to stay with his wonderful family. He had a little girl, a little boy, and his wife, Melanie. So there I was coming from the industrial side, Hamburg, Germany, arriving in LA, sitting by the pool with a little, with a chilled Coke. So life was really good. I didn't know what was striking me, but I was heavily excited. And just a few days later, after I kind of recovered from jet lag, he introduced me right away to Bruce Gowdy. And I must say, Bruce and I hit it off very well. Great guy, unbelievably talented, very smart. And he back then already had a very developed sense of, how can I put this, like poppy writing, you know. I mean, I was more like the streety guy, like, hey, get out of my way, fuck you, AC/DC, shabba labba. And that was Bruce, more the controlled, smart, like, hey, let's arrange this in a more commercial, proper, whatever way, you know, if you kind of understand what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things I wanted to ask you, because when you listen to Stone Fury, it's kind of got two different sides. You kind of got like a little harder side, which I would call the Kingdom Come type of side, then you got more of a poppier type of side. So I always thought, and don't take this the wrong way, I always thought the poppier stuff was something that was maybe manufactured or pushed by the record label. But hearing it that came from Bruce kind of surprised me a little bit, because I always thought that he was more of the rocking type of guitar player. But hearing that from you, I guess it changes the whole dynamic now.
Well, no, I mean, there's a truth to be found on both sides, basically. Bruce definitely was more the poppy, thought-out, commercial, guided writer. And there I was, pretty much out of control, you know, live wire, highway to hell, you know, coming from the streets. But that kind of had a certain charm. I mean, John Lennon, he was the guy throwing up, and Paul McCartney was singing "And I Love Her," you know. I mean, so it's always about the chemistry, the magic, about partnerships. And but if I'm looking back, especially at the productions, I have to say, trying to keep it short, Andy Johns, who produced the first record, it was a fantastic time to hang with him, to work with him. I learned a lot, and life was beautiful. But it was not always easy because Andy, he was like a walking, I don't know, a six-pack machine, I don't know. I mean, he was constantly under the influence of beer bottles, and it was sometimes hard to get things done because he had to listen to his latest conclusion of, you know, of his of the sense of life or whatever. So it was very funny, but it was, let me put it politely, very time-taking, difficult at times, but a very, very charming guy, and no regrets whatsoever, and he certainly did a good job for Stone Fury, and he also knew how to kind of adapt the Bruce Gowdish poppy feel to what I wanted to kind of hear. You have to remember, back then I wasn't really able to express myself very well. So instead of saying, could you please like give the guitar a bit more edge and make the kick a bit heavier, I just said, oh, fuck this, shit. So he had to kind of like dive into this, like, what is Lenny trying to tell me, you know? So it wasn't exactly always easy for him, and obviously not for me. But hey, it was a growing experience, and unfortunately, he just passed away a little while ago, so which is a shame, but he was a wonderful guy. So much for Stone Fury with Andy Johns. Let me just round it up quickly by... with the second record, which is called Let Them Talk. When Bruce Gowdy came around the corner with a demo, Let Them Talk, it was really cool. We're talking like a four-track, lousy demo, but it had a very particular feel to it, and it was exciting. And because of the first record didn't do very well, MCA decided to put us in touch with a guy called Richard Landis. Back then he was known to produce country acts and stuff like that. He certainly did not know what it meant to come from the streets and give it that cobblestone, like mean, edgy, rocking feel. He didn't know how to spell that. So that was really, that really turned into a nightmare. Actually, towards the end of the record, the label and Richard Landis asked me to stay out of the studio because it was a constant fight. Again, my English was still limited. I couldn't really get my point across in a most delightful way all the time. And there was a guy coming from the countryside not knowing what rock and roll meant whatsoever. So it was just a pain in the neck for me, and the whole record, if it comes to my modest self, self's opinion, it just turned to shit. The potential is great, but the production, I regret immensely. But it is what it is. You know, the past belongs to all of us. Nothing we can do about it, and no regrets once again. It was a learning experience. But after that, I decided never ever again will somebody force anybody onto me, which I don't want to work with or hang with or whatsoever. Yeah, and that's when MCA dropped the ball, and I was basically completely broke. And Marty said, Lenny, here's another $5. Go to McDonald's, you know, get yourself a big cheeseburger and a Coke, get some energy, and go back in the room and just write. That's what I did for 3-4 weeks, writing. He took the tape, went to all the labels he could think of. Back in the days, there were still a lot of labels going around, and going on, like Warner's, Chrysalis, Electra, whatever, Polygram. Basically, everybody passed except Polygram Records out of New York, and the head of A&R, his name was Derek Schulman. Great guy, fantastic guy. He actually signed Bon Jovi and Cinderella. And he heard some potential in my voice, writing, what do I know? And he said, Lenny, okay, I'm going to give it a shot, but you got to promise me, find a good band, and let's start working with that. I said, hey, sure, sounds great. I want to work with a band. I don't want to be the main cheese, and I certainly don't want it to be a solo project. So rock and roll sounds great.
All right, Lenny, so why don't we go ahead and close the book on Stone Fury, and why don't we play a track and basically transition from Stone Fury, and is there a track you want to go ahead and have us play on the station? Maybe give us a little info on that track.
Okay, how about let's give Life Is Too Lonely a shot here now. And what can I tell you? Yeah, it's one of the songs which I don't just like, but also the production side of it kind of worked well for me. Meanwhile, as I was saying earlier on, some of the songs, I think the potential is there, but the production didn't work out. But Life Is Too Lonely, I think it's a great It's going to give you a great idea what's going on there. Sure, cool. Yeah, dig it. Rock and roll. Play it. If you like it, tell me. If you don't, tell somebody else.
All right, so is there any truth that Don Dokken wanted to cover that song?
Yes, I'm not making up, please. I mean, why should I make that up? Don Dokken and I have been good friends for many, many years. I mean, obviously things, I mean, our contact has kind of like faded a bit because I moved back to Hamburg, Germany, which is basically my, you know, where I came from. And so we're not in touch as often as we used to. I mean, we were driving the Harley throughout the desert and just hanging. I mean, good guy. Yeah, I mean, he just approached me like a few times and he wanted to cover the songs. Back then, honestly, I didn't quite know how he would sing it because he would really down-tune it a lot. Even I could not sing that sucker nowadays anymore. Yeah, but it's just one of those, you know, little things which happened. And I just mentioned it, you know, nothing earth-shaking, but...
All right. Cool. All right, here you go. This is Life is Too Lonely from Stone Fury. We'll be back after this.